The condition number is an indicator of the geometry of the function, and its value influences a lot some of the algorithms. So it's possible to change the formulation of the problem in order to get a better value for this indicator. This modification is called preconditioning. It's changing the condition number of a problem. And some algorithms actually do it automatically. So in this video, we will try to understand what is the condition number and what do we mean by preconditioning. We first start by the definition of the condition number of a matrix, which comes from linear algebra. Well, the definition is that the condition number of a matrix A is the norm of A multiplied by the norm of the inverse of A, if this inverse exists. And when the matrix is symmetric, positive, definite, in this case, the condition number, kappa of A, is actually equal to the ratio between the largest and the smallest eigenvalues. That's the way the condition number of a matrix is defined in linear algebra. Okay, now let's go back to the optimization context. Let's consider a function f, and let's consider a value of x such that the second derivative matrix is positive definite. We define lambda 1 to be its largest eigenvalue, and d1 would be the corresponding eigenvector. It means that the Hessians time d1 is equal to lambda 1 times d1. So this is the equation characterizing the eigenvalue and the eigenvectors. So now let's pre-multiply this by d1 transposed. We obtain lambda 1 times d1 transpose d1. And now we divide everything by d1 transpose dy. Okay, so after having done these manipulations, we have an expression of lambda 1, which depends on the second derivative matrix, and the vector d1, which is the eigenvector. But if you remember when we analyzed the second derivative matrix, this quantity which is on the left was interpreted as the curvature of the function at x along d1. So this is interesting because it gives us an interpretation of the eigenvalue. So lambda 1, the eigenvalue of the Hessian matrix, represents actually the curvature of the function along the direction d1, where d1 is the associated eigenvector. Now it means that when we are calculating the condition number of the Hessian matrix, which is the ratio between the largest eigenvalue and the smallest eigenvalue, it means that from a geometric point of view, we are actually calculating the ratio between the largest curvature and the smallest curvature. Let's try to illustrate this on some examples. So this example, where f of x is defined as x1 squared plus x2 squared, is plotted here using the level curves. So each circle here represents all the points that have the exact same value of the function. And each curve corresponds to a different level. So it's like on a geographical map, the level curves. This gives us some information about the geometry of the function. The fact that the level curves are circular is a sign that the curvature of the function is actually the same in every direction. And actually, in this case, the condition number of the function at x, which is the condition number of the second derivative matrix, happens to be 1, because the curvature is the same in all directions. It means that the largest eigenvalue is the same as the smallest eigenvalue, because they are interpreted as the curvature, and therefore the ratio is equal to 1. Now, if we take another example where the curvature is not the same in every direction, so we see here that the level curves are elliptic. These are ellipses. So it means that the curvature in this direction is smaller than the curvature in this direction. In this case, it can be calculated that it's actually 10 times bigger. So the ratio between the largest curvature and the smallest curvature is equal to 10. This is the condition number at x. And we can go one step further. If we push it a little bit more, we see that the level curves are more and more elongated. So the ratio between the highest curvature and the smallest curvature is even bigger. Here it's 100. So we can see this as some sort of a valley, okay? So this is relatively flat along x1, but when you go along x2, you have a very steep way down and a very steep way up, like in a valley, in a narrow valley in the mountains. So this is typically a problem which we will define as ill-conditioned. So the condition number is high, and we will see that for some algorithm, it will be actually difficult to deal with such problems. But actually, the condition number of a function, the conditioning of the function, can be modified by a change of variable. So suppose that we use a new set of variable x prime that is defined as m times x, where m is an invertible matrix. So equivalently, we can write x to be m minus 1 x prime. In this case, we can define a new function in the new variables x prime that is defined as the value of the function f evaluated at m minus 1 x prime. So in this case, when we calculate the derivatives of this f tilde function, we obtain for the gradient m minus t, which means the inverse of the transpose of m, times the gradient of f at minus 1 x prime. And if we calculate now the second derivative matrix, it's equal to m minus t times the second derivative of f at m minus 1 x prime times m minus 1, which is also equal to m minus t times the Hessian of f at x, m minus 1. So of course, because we pre-multiply this matrix by m minus t and m minus 1, the condition number of the Hessian matrix of f tilde will be different from the condition number of the function f. Therefore, the idea of preconditioning, it's about finding a change of variable defined by the matrix M, such that the condition number of F tilde, as defined on this slide, will be better than the condition number of F. We have seen that the condition number reflects the geometry of the function through the ratio of extreme curvatures. And it can be changed with an appropriate change of variables. And this change of variable is called preconditioning.